Hi, my name is Theodore Gray. In 1988, I co-founded Wolfram Research along with Stephen Wolfram and others. Somewhere around 2002, I kind of accidentally got sidetracked and started working on a periodic table, which is what you see here. Around 2002, I read this book, Uncle Tungsten, by Oliver Sacks, which is a wonderful book. And he has a paragraph in there where he describes a periodic table in the Kensington Science Museum, and he describes it as having samples on it. It turns out I was just misunderstanding his description of the thing, and it's actually a wall display. It's the same as everybody else's periodic table. But this kind of put the idea in my head that there ought to be a periodic table. And as far as I could tell, no one had ever done it before. I kind of researched the situation. And that's what caused me to build it, is I thought the world needs a periodic table. So, I mean, there's lots of different elements in here. Hydrogen is a little tricky because it's a gas. So this is a little aspirin bottle, which at one time was filled with actual hydrogen, and a key card from the Hydrogen Hotel. This is a sample I don't usually keep out because if somebody were to drop it and break the bottle, it would really be bad. I think OSHA would have opinions about spilled mercury in a workplace. Really like tungsten. You can't quite get an impression of it, but that took me a while practicing being able to actually lift this thing because this weighs about 11 pounds. So everyone always asks me what my favorite element is, so I had to make up titanium as my favorite element. And this is an intake. It's called a blisk, a bladed impeller disc. So niobium is nice. It's one of its more popular uses is for piercing jewelry because it's hypoallergenic. It's compatible with tissue. The noble gases are relatively easy to display because they have very nice discharge colors. You can see an example of neon up there. Chlorine, if you hold it up to a white surface, you can make out the yellow tint in it. Bromine, even more so. That's got a much stronger color to it. Bismuth, it just wants to crystallize like this. It's hard to stop it when it cools. This is an ingot of indium, which I got. I think I paid $200 for this. The safe is where I keep some of the more valuable samples. 3.5 ounces, roughly, of gold. Very old silver coins. Platinum mesh. A random collection of ingots. A gold nugget. 1 ounce of platinum. 10 ounces of silver, which used to be not worth much, and recently the price of silver has gone through the roof. Silver bullets. I made these for one of my columns. Kind of fun, you know, for werewolf purposes. Niobium crystal bar. It's created by a refining process that's no longer used, so hard to get. Rhenium, which was not particular. I think I bought it for $700. At one time it was worth many thousands. Very dense, very nice stuff. I don't know how many samples I have. It's several thousand. I haven't counted recently. Only a very small amount of it is in the actual table. These two cases have many of the sort of interesting ones, the sort of more attractive looking ones. There's a bunch of stuff in here. It's not terribly well organized. This is a bottle of radithor, which I won't touch because the cork is quite radioactive. This is one of my favorite tungsten samples. It's ear weights. If you have a dog breed whose ears are meant to hang down, you can spread wax on the inside of the ear and sprinkle this powder on. That will supposedly add enough weight to get your dog's ears to lie flat. Beryllium gyroscope spheres, extremely precise spheres. They're said to be among the most accurate spheres ever made. There are various different purity levels of silicon. Why Homer Simpson is etched on that wafer is a question that I really have no idea. Actual human bone with a fake knee implant in it, made of aluminum. Sulfur used to be very commonly available in pharmacies. When I was a kid, I worked hard at figuring out how to buy sulfur because you needed to make gunpowder. And the most important factor about buying sulfur when you're a kid is don't try to buy saltpeter at the same pharmacy, because then they really know what you're going to do with it. The three shells are white phosphorus incendiary mortar shells. The long thin thing with veins at the back is unfortunately a simulated depleted uranium tank penetrator. Yeah, well, I mean, I figured when I got started with this, I thought, you know, my dad collected rocks, for example, and he spent, you know, his whole life, every once in a while, he'd buy another really nice rock. And after 30 or 40 years, he had a fantastic collection of rocks and minerals. And so I thought, you know, I'll just kind of, I'm not really interested in this stuff. And, you know, if I happen to be traveling somewhere, I happen to see an interesting element, maybe I'll pick it up. And 30 years from now, maybe I'll have an element collection. And then I go on eBay, and it's like, oh, I could get that. And there's that. And look, he's also got this thing. And, you know, 6 months later, I had pretty much a complete set.